Greetings, everyone. Raymond Lacoste here, Senior Technical Instructor at Stormwind Studios. And today, I'm going to share with you four critical AWS vulnerabilities and how you can protect yourself. But before we dive into these four critical vulnerabilities, we need to know what a vulnerability is. So let's think about that for just a moment. What is a vulnerability? Well, the easiest way to describe a vulnerability is anything. That's right, anything that if exposed could have a major or even minor impact on our organization. That's right, negative impact on our organization. Let me give you an example. Outside of the world of AWS, outside of the world of IT, and that is Star Wars Episode 4. That's right. If you haven't seen Star Wars Episode 4, which was released in the 1970s, I want you to plug your ears right now. That's right. Spoiler alert. I do not want to ruin Star Wars for you. What do we have? We have a Death Star. The Death Star has a vulnerability. What is that vulnerability? An exhaust port. That's right. An exhaust port. The Empire didn't even recognize that as a vulnerability. But it is. So we have this vulnerability. Now, if somebody recognizes that as a vulnerability, they can expose it. So the Rebel Alliance recognizes that's a vulnerability. They expose it. And then what happens? Boom. That's right. The Death Star goes kaboom. I told you. Spoiler alert. Right. So you have to recognize in your own organization vulnerabilities. Do you have any vulnerabilities that if left unchecked, boom. Now, you might not be able to eliminate your vulnerabilities. For example, would the Empire be able to eliminate the exhaust port vulnerability? No, not eliminate it. But what if they put a covering over top of it? So that way their bombs couldn't be dropped into it. They reduce the likelihood of the vulnerability being exposed. So we can't always eliminate vulnerabilities, but we can reduce the exposure factor of that vulnerability. So let's dive in here. Let's take a look at the four critical AWS vulnerabilities and how we can protect ourselves. But I want you to realize I am not going to sugarcoat this discussion, not at all. This is gonna be a brutal discussion. This is gonna be a gut check. Why? Because the very first critical AWS vulnerability is you. We have to recognize that. We have to take ownership that we are a critical AWS vulnerability. Now, why? Well, you know, I see you implementing security groups, implementing network access control lists with a source of 0.0.0.0/0 for management access. That's right. You are allowing anybody in the entire world the ability to connect via SSH and RDP to your devices in the AWS environment. For management purposes, really? Yeah, I see that. And you might be saying, well, I have no other option. All right, fine. But most of us do have another option. Are we going to eliminate the vulnerability completely? No, but we can shrink the size of the vulnerability. I'm going to show you how to do that today. All right, so now that we got you out of the way, what is number two? It's you. That's right, it's you. I told you I wasn't going to sugarcoat this. You give IAM users way more privileges than they need. Now, you're not doing that on purpose. I know you're not. But it happens because we don't take the extra time to make sure that we enforce the least privilege principle, which means only give IAM users the privileges they need to do their jobs. So if this user is responsible for EC2 instances and they don't need access to S3 buckets, don't give them access to S3 buckets. It's that simple. Only give them access to EC2. So we're going to look at a way that we can help you make sure that you're only giving the privileges that a user needs. All right, number three. You do what? You don't encrypt S3 buckets or the objects in those S3 buckets or even your EBS volumes. So what happens now? Well, let me tell you what happens. In a perfect world, nothing happens. But we don't live in a perfect world. So what's going to happen is we're going to end up in a situation where some unauthorized user accesses the buckets or the objects or the EBS volumes, and they take that information. And since it's not encrypted, they can easily read it. That's right, they can easily read it now. It's in plain text, it's not encrypted. That is a vulnerability. And this needs to be solved. And number four, I think you know what the critical AWS vulnerability is here. Number four, it's you. That's right. You create S3 buckets and you grant it public access, meaning everybody in the entire world on the internet has access to your bucket now. All right. So what do you think number five, number six, number seven, number eight, number nine, number infinity would be? It's you all across the board. And the reason for this is because of AWS's shared responsibility model. What do we mean by shared responsibility model? It means that AWS is responsible for certain security requirements. You are responsible for certain security requirements. So we need to take the time to understand AWS's shared security model. You are required to do that. So that way there, you know what you are responsible for, and therefore you know how to reduce the size of your vulnerabilities, and therefore reduce your exposure to those malicious users of the world. So I promised you I would show you how to protect yourself here from these four critical AWS vulnerabilities. So that's what we're gonna focus on today, are these four. So number one is, don't use 0.0.0.0/0 in your security groups or network access control lists as the source. So right here is the source. So this is a security group I created for Linux web servers. So we access our Linux web servers using SSH for management purposes. And those Linux web servers are gonna have a public-private key pair. So the server has the public key stored on it, and you would have to have the private key in order to access it. So already, a malicious user would need to get access to the private key, which they shouldn't have access to, but if they did, you're now granting them the ability to connect from any IP address in the entire world. So we could reduce the size of our vulnerability here, shrink this source from 0.0.0.0/0 down to, let's say, the public IP address range of your corporate network, or some special IP address range we're using for management purposes. That's even better, right? So if I shrink that source down to that specific address range, then that means only devices with a source address in that range can connect via SSH to this EC2 instance. In addition, that user would need the private key that corresponds with the public key on the server in order to gain successful access. So we're not completely eliminating our vulnerability, because a hacker could do what? A hacker could spoof the IP address range, but we're reducing the vulnerability down to an acceptable size. That's what we're doing in this case. Likewise, for Windows access. With Windows access, you need an administrator or a username and password. That's what I meant to say, a username and password to connect into the Windows devices. But if you have a source of 0.0.0/0 for your security group, then that means anybody is going to be allowed to connect that has that username and password from any IP address. But we could reduce the size of this source down to an acceptable size, like we did with the Linux security group, to make sure that only the administrators in this particular management network are going to be able to use RDP port 3389 with a very specific source range of IP addresses in order to manage our devices. So again, not completely eliminating the vulnerability, but we're reducing the size of that vulnerability, therefore reducing the exposure. Like the Death Star, the Empire could have reduced the exposure by putting a cover on the exhaust port. It's kind of the idea. Now, when it comes to the privileges of the IAM users, how do we make sure our IAM users don't have more privileges than they need? Well, we could look at all the different policies we've attached to those users, and we can go through them line by line, step by step, and try to figure out with some sort of diagram exactly what privileges that user has. Or we could use the IAM policy simulator, which I'm showing here. So this IAM policy simulator is going to take a look at the different users, groups, or roles you have in your AWS account and the policies that are attached to those users, groups, or roles. And then you can run a simulator on them. So in this case, we chose our user, Jane Doe. So there's Jane Doe. Jane Doe has these policies assigned to her. It would be a very daunting task to go through all those policies on my own to figure out what Jane Doe can and cannot do. Instead, with this policy simulator, I pick my service. I then choose the action that I want to run the simulation on. In this case, we chose all actions in relation to the EC2 service. And then we go ahead and we run our simulation. And in this case, we'll see that Jane has the ability to terminate EC2 instances. And I'm not happy with that, because no one should have the ability to directly terminate an EC2 instance. There's better ways to grant users the ability to terminate an EC2 instance. And that's reserved for another discussion. So in this case, I would want to change this. I do not want Jane Doe to have the ability to terminate instances directly. And we can see here, if we expand out that section of the policy simulator, it says these three policies allow her to terminate. So what we want to do is we either want to create another policy that explicitly says Jane Doe is never allowed to terminate EC2 instances, or we can go ahead and edit policies to remove that ability to terminate EC2 instances. But this IAM policy simulator, fabulous tool for you to verify exactly what actions IAM users are going to be allowed to perform given a set of policies and permissions you've attached to them. Take advantage of that. Again, reducing your vulnerability down to a manageable level. Next, encryption. We fail to do encryption in this world because sometimes encryption is extremely difficult to implement. Managing keys, distribution of keys, can be a very daunting task. But with AWS, they make it really easy for S3 and for EBS volume. So there's no reason why we shouldn't be taking advantage of encryption. So with our EBS volumes, we just go to the volume, and while we're creating that volume, we click on this button. And then it's going to ask us, what keys do you want to use for encryption? You can use the default keys, which means I don't have to do anything else. Just select them and move on. Or we could use some custom key that we created. Very, very simple to encrypt all information that is on an EBS volume. And also, it would also encrypt all information in transit from an EC2 instance to an EBS volume. So take advantage of that. Also, with our S3 buckets, we do not have encryption on by default, but we can turn it on by going to the properties of the bucket, turning on encryption. You can see here that by default, there's none. But I can choose AES 256 or AWS KMS. And then by providing the encryption on the objects in this bucket, if anybody gets access to the objects in the bucket that shouldn't have access to objects in the bucket, they're not going to be able to read that information because it's encrypted. So the key here is we can protect ourselves with multiple layers by ensuring that we have encryption as well as other security features in place. So that way there, if that information is ever grabbed, it's no big deal. Why? Because it's encrypted. And if we use the right level of encryption, then that means it might take them 100 years or 1,000 years to decrypt it and read it. And in that case, That's fine, because that information is useless in 100 years or 1,000 years. And last but not least, this is a big one. Do not use public access for S3 buckets or objects in S3 buckets unless you know 100% without a doubt that is exactly what you want to do. Right? I'm fine with you using public access, meaning internet access for the entire world. I'm fine with that. AWS is fine with that. But the problem we're running into is that S3 buckets and objects in the S3 buckets have public access for a lot of organizations that shouldn't have public access. Every day, I scour the internet for AWS news articles just to see what's going on out there, right? And I often come across articles about leaky S3 buckets. Just type in leaky S3 buckets in your favorite browser search engine. Let me tell you, you're going to come across a lot of articles about leaky S3 buckets because people create these buckets. You create these buckets. And under the access control list permissions, you, under everyone, say, well, I need to grant everyone access. Well, no, wait a second. Okay, this is not everyone in your organization. This is everyone in the entire world. That's what this access control list is for. Granting access to other AWS accounts as an example. It says right here, other AWS accounts. Everyone has access. Ooh, so I've given it public access. And this feature is relatively new. AWS has added the orange glowing public icon to the console because a lot of buckets out there are public, and that makes them leaky buckets, they're referred to as. So through access control lists, if any of these say yes, it means you have a publicly accessible bucket. What about objects themselves? Well, likewise, if we dive into the object, in this case, this is an object inside of this bucket here. Well, again, we go down to public access. Yes, that means people on the internet have the ability to access this. Is that really what I want? If it's not what I want, we got to get rid of this. We do not want public access on that. And then we also have what are known as bucket policies for S3. So our bucket policy here is public. Now, what has made this bucket policy public? How does AWS know it's public? Well, let me show you. It's this right here. The star, the asterisk. Attached to who? Principal. Principal is, you know, who is allowed access to this bucket. That's what the principal is. So is Jane Doe allowed access? Is Raymond Lacoste allowed access? Is Dan Young allowed access? Well, star means everyone, meaning the entire world, the internet is allowed access. That right there is what makes this public. And what's even worse about this policy is that the action is all actions on S3. Create buckets, delete buckets, delete objects, create objects. So this is a really bad policy because it grants everybody in the entire world unlimited access to this particular bucket right here. And there's the resource. So, in conclusion, what are the four critical AWS vulnerabilities? Do you remember? It's you, 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 and you. And there are more. But today we've only looked at four and how we can protect ourselves from ourselves. Remember, AWS is a shared responsibility model for security. You're responsible for your side of things. They're responsible for their side of things. So take the time to make sure you are securing your side of things as best you can. Take advantage of the tools, take advantage of the resources that will protect you and your organization from the Death Star experience, right? So folks, from all of us here at Stormwind Studios, happy learning, everybody. Take care and bye from now.